Well, I've got a thought about her being a killer queen as it relates to a murder one charge, but take a listen to this, John.
Okay.
Linda Henning wanted to became a queen in her mind, and she perceived a great threat to planet Earth and that she would have to fight other queens. And the evidence, the paperwork in this case suggests that Girly was that threat. She had been convinced that Girly was that threat, that she would have to be killed.
Joining us by phone now is Mark Horner. Mark is a reporter for KOB TV in Albuquerque, and he was so struck by the story of Girly Chew and her disappearance that he set up a website on the topic. That's markhorner.com. Welcome to the program, Mark.
Hi, Lisa. Thank you for having me.
Now, I've looked at your website. It's quite good. There's a lot of detail, a lot of interesting articles on there. I especially like that you said, welcome, Court TV viewers, when I went on there yesterday, Mark.
I had a feeling some few would find me.
And I was one of them, in fact, and I felt very personally welcome to your website.
Thanks.
What motivated you to set up a website about this case?
Well, believe it or not, it was out of a bit of frustration back in the fall of 1999. Came across this case, and it was a kind of a low-profile case initially, yet I recognized what I thought was a pretty, quite frankly, a very tragic story. Mm. And this was before we learned about aliens and some of the more sensational aspects of it, but this was, at its very core, a domestic violence case.
Why do you say that, Mark?
A domestic violence case?
Why do you think that's the core of the case?
Well, I think you could wrap it any way you want. The themes that run through this, namely control and somebody wanting what he wants to have but not being able to have it, those are some age-old themes that go back generations upon generations. In the case of Girly Chew Hossencofft, I was struck by all of the efforts that she made really to rescue herself. She mm-hmm. took the very brave step of getting out of that household and then trying to build a life away from this man that she perceived as a very immediate threat. And this is a woman who comes from a country halfway around the world, so on top of everything else, you know, she had to learn our system and how to do all of that. And she reaches out, she cries out for help, and to her final day she goes to the FBI of all places.
Yeah, and they don't give her any help either, Mark. This is James Curtis here again. Welcome to the program. Talk to me about this problem with identifying this sword that was obtained as part of the evidence as the murder weapon. Not everyone was convinced that it was actually the murder weapon.
Well, that's correct, James. The prosecution believes, it has been documented in court, that it was instrumental in committing the crime. However, when you listen to, and I think you have on your witness list coming up, the DNA expert who did a lot of the DNA work in the police lab, Catherine Dickey, what she
right.
has to say about the forensics and the DNA in this case will be very intriguing. And there is a line of thought with the prosecution, it seems to me, very directly, that she was actually shot to death, Girly Chew Hossencofft, and that her body was laid out on a tarp and that she was cut up into pieces with that sword.
Mark, answer a question for me with respect to the prosecutors. I don't know. It just seems to be a little out of whack, this prosecution. You've got Diazien Hossencofft, who doesn't get prosecuted. They're not trying to put him to death. They cut a deal with this guy, yet they try to put Linda Henning to death. That's her attempt in this case that we're now observing. And the other guy, William Miller, he doesn't even get indicted for murder. What's going on with this case? How did it get so askew?
Well, I think bottom line is they wanted to have all three people, in their minds, all three people are guilty here. So they wanted to see accountability spread across the board here to all three. Initially, they have Hossencofft, and eventually he cops a plea. So what they're thinking at that time, it seems to me, is that they can use his testimony, they think, to nail Henning and to nail Bill Miller. They wasted, as you know, very little time going back to the grand jury on Miller, but that was perhaps, it's been suggested by some of your own experts, a hasty move, because look what they had on the guy, right down to the conspiracy to commit murder, the kidnapping charges, so many serious crimes, and now what's left there, because the grand jury only came back with the tampering.
Yes, that is a really troubling part of the case. Mark, we're showing this case all week here at Court TV. On Thursday, we'll be showing Diazien Hossencofft himself on the stand. He's such a strange-looking guy with those weird smiles and the long fingernails. Give us a little preview of what he's like on the stand.
Well, he certainly captures the attention of everybody in that courtroom. But let me back up. From the moment I first saw Diazien Hossencofft, when he first appeared finally in a Bernalillo County courtroom, it's been quite apparent to me that the man loves the spotlight. And you can just imagine a guy who's a self-described con man who's manipulated so many people. Now he gets, you know, he gets the ultimate stage, a national television audience, and he knew Court TV was going to be there. He knew that this had been making some headlines and papers around the world. So he was really, I think, gearing up, living for this moment to finally arrive. And quite frankly, he electrifies the courtroom, but he is so ego-filled nonstop that after maybe 90 minutes, I think, quite frankly, that even he gets tired of himself. By that point, people in the courtroom certainly do. He comes in, he lays on this thick accent, and even after 90 minutes, you'll notice the accent becomes inconsistent. He starts losing the accent at times.
All right, Mark Horner, well, we will watch for that when we see Diazien himself testify. In the meantime, thank you for joining us, and everybody can check out all of the information on your website, markhorner.com.
Thanks, Mark. You're great.
We're going to go back into the courtroom.
Lead prosecutor Paul Spears and investigative reporter for KOB-TV in Albuquerque, Mark Horner. Mark, how has the community responded to this sort of thing? Because it's quite bizarre. One of those things that, oh my God, there's a cult next door.
Yeah, it's funny. I think about the time that the trial was unfolding, and there's a nearby coffee shop, and even the young people, 18, 19, 20 years old, who work in that coffee shop were quite abuzz with what was coming out all of a sudden through this case. But of course, much of it has been there all along for 3+ years, buried in the police reports and the court documents, the inventory returns, the transcripts of interviews. And now, not only all of Albuquerque, but certainly much of the country has become aware of this case. And right now, Catherine, everybody's just waiting for a sentencing date. We were given a 60-day time frame. I think we're basically upon that or past that now. But as of this moment, we don't have a firm sentencing date.
Well, the judge seems to, or seemed at the time, to want her to cooperate, that he sort of opened the door saying, tell us where the body is and maybe this will help you out. We got the comment from her on Court TV, but I guess you also observed her. Her demeanor at the time, she didn't seem very cooperative, did she?
Not cooperative at all, Catherine. I think you picked the quintessential soundbite when you began the segment, and you had Judge Brennan giving his reasoning from the bench. And I thought it was quite brilliant and a bit of a surprise to do exactly what he did on the front end, and that is to provide this opportunity for the defendant, Linda Henning, to perhaps provide some information that could hopefully bring some much-needed closure for Girly Chew's family half a world away in Malaysia. No doubt this is very important. They want to come here, find those remains in whatever state they may be, have her remains cremated, bring her back to Malaysia, and have her in a temple.
We want to play for you a remark made by a TV reporter who's just telling about how easy it would be out in this remote mining area to dispose of a body and it would never be found.
You can go to one of these mines and hold a boulder and let go and wait to hear it drop, and you'll never hear it. And the thought that she could be at the bottom of one of those is very cold and disturbing, because there are so many mines like that out there that if she's in the bottom of a mine, to her family's disappointment, there's very little hope that she will ever be found.